Good morning. What a wonderful way to worship the Holy Spirit in swag this morning. That was lovely. That was lovely. Chris did a wonderful job with that song. Wonderful words of life. It's so wonderful to see all of you out this morning in this cold, cold weather. But at least the sun is shining, so we have to thank God for the sunshine. We appreciate each of you all being here this morning. We're so glad to see everyone. And those online, we especially welcome you today.
In the center of worship, as you know, there's a Can You Help table, and we have travel bags, and they are back in a big cubby, and you're welcome to put one in your car. And when you see someone on the side of the road or at the grocery store that is in need, this is a great kit to hand them that has snacks and body wash and toothbrush and a fresh pair of socks and all kinds of good stuff, just to let them know that we care. So it's an easy way to be in ministry and to share God's love. Look on your pew. You're going to see our next fellowship lunch. It's called Pizza and Trivia. It will be in our fellowship hall downstairs, but Hill and Holler is going to bring the pizza. So we hope that you'll come. It is going to be such a good time of connection. We just did bingo last week, and everybody won like 2 or 3 prizes. It was so fun. So we hope that you'll come to the next one. It is on February 4th. We need your help with a few sign-up items, things that we need. So if you'll go to the Can You Help table, we would love for you to bring an item to sign up for. And of course, now we want to remind you again that our property across from the parsonage has sold, and that's going to help us in a lot of different ways. So Boots has to come and do a reading because of the sale of the property.
Please take notice that in connection with the Raise the Roof project previously approved by the congregation, West Virginia Code 35-1-10 requires notice to the congregation that on or after the 22nd day of January 2024, the trustees of Lewisburg United Methodist Church will sell the vacant lots on Alderson Street, Lewisburg Municipality, Greenbrier County, West Virginia, which were devised by the trustees of the Lewisburg United Methodist Church by the will of Beatrice B. Harvey, dated May 21st, 1999, of record in the office of the clerk of the County Commission of Greenbrier County, West Virginia, in will book number 52 at page 307, to Marvin and Deborah Boggs for the sum of $65,000, which will be used to help pay for the cost of the new roof on the church. That's the protocol part. The good part is, look around you. Each of you, many of you, dug deep in your pockets and your checkbooks and provided funding. And with the sale of this property, the Raise the Roof has been a success, and there's no debt. Thank you.
I'm going to say one more thing, and then you'll do the greeting. Owen Vogelsong is our youth leader and has been an intern here. He was supposed to be our speaker this morning, but he's at Concord University and is snowed in. So we will pivot and shift and still have a time of worship together.
Tell someone one thing you love about Lewisburg United Methodist Church worship. Stand and greet each other. Remain standing and let's sing our opening hymn.
Oh, As we call our hearts to worship, in just a moment I'm going to ask that you read scripture with me. But let me open by saying that Paul reminds us in this passage that without love, we are nothing. If I speak in the tongues of men and or of angels, but I do not have love, I'm just a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and I can fathom all the mysteries of the world and have all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. Sing with me the song, The Gift of Love.
Though I may speak with bravest fire and have the gift to all inspire and have not love, my words are vain as sounding brass and hopeless gain. Come, Spirit, and are free.
Be collecting your noisy offering for community needs, a way that we can share love amongst ourselves right here in Lewisburg. And as you do that, let the children come forward for a word from Tina.
Good morning, everybody. How are you? Good. Make sure you turn around so you can see. Did you know when I was a kid, I played percussion? I loved percussion. One of my favorite instruments was the cymbals, and I would like to bang them all the time. Am I not a good cymbalist?
No.
Did you not like that sound?
It's just loud.
It's loud?
And they hurt our ears.
It hurts your ears? And it's off tune. What about this sound? How about that?
Yeah.
You like that? I played that instrument too. So this instrument sounds better than this. You don't like it. Hurts your ears, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Well, you know what? There's a scripture in the Bible that we just talked about. It's from 1 Corinthians 13. And Paul said that if you say mean things, it sounds like this. But if you say nice things in love, it sounds like this. Okay, so we're going to practice. say something nice. What's something nice? What can you say in love that's nice?
You're very nice.
You're very nice. Okay. Anybody? Anybody? What can you say that would sound like love? Here's a real simple one. I love you. Can you say that? I love you. Aww. What about I hate you? Oh, okay, okay. Let's play a little game. I say a word and you tell me what I should do. Ready? You look very nice today. You are so mean. Gotcha. All right, you did a very good job. So I just want you to remember that when you say nice things, it should sound like this in our hearts. But when you say mean things or you're mean to your brother or sister, what's it sound like? I'm not going to do it because I've hurt your ears too much. All right? So just remember, mean words are like a clashing cymbal or lids. But love sounds great. All right, let's say a little prayer and everybody can repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for Jesus.
Thank you for Jesus.
And thank you for love.
And thank you for love.
Help me to remember that my words need to be nice and sound pretty instead of mean. And sounding like a crashing cymbal. I love you, and I know you love me too. Amen. Thank you very much. Have a great week. Help me collect a noisy offering.
Might have to be in the right key before you try to do that. So let's try that again.
So unusual, it's frightening. As you can see the mess inside me, and you pull me out, you pull me in. You're telling me that I can start again. I don't have to keep on hiding. I'm fully known and loved by you. You won't let go, no matter what I do. It's not one or the other. It's hard to thin ridiculous grace to be known and fully known and loved by you. It's so like you to keep pursuing. So like me to go astray. and said you pull me out and pull me in, and telling me that I can start again, and I don't have to keep on hiding. I'm fully known and loved by you. You don't let go, no matter what I do. It's not a one or the other. It's hard truth and ridiculous grace to be known, fully known and loved by you. It's not one or the other. It's hard truth and ridiculous grace to be known and fully known and loved by you.
Good morning. The scripture is from 1 Corinthians 13. For now we see only a reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three things remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
We are in the middle of the series Wordle, which is a reminder that God's word is still alive and it's inspired and it's God-breathed. And so I want to remind you of why we are in the series. Isaiah says, God's word, when it goes out, will not return empty or void. In fact, Isaiah tells us a lot of things that God's word will do for your heart. Isaiah says it will produce good things. It will change hearts. It will accomplish God's plan. It will give purpose to the reader. And it will prosper and grow you. So oftentimes when you're in small groups with me, we encourage you to do a meditation, which is what we'll be doing this morning. We're going to encourage you to listen, to see, to be open to God's word. And I want you to pick something that stands out for you. When God's word goes out, he says it will not return empty, it will not return void, which means it is going to speak to your heart. And it may speak differently. It may speak differently to one person than another. There may be a word or a phrase that speaks out differently. So we're going to read the passage of scripture for you this morning. We're going to read over your hearts. And as Toni reads over these words of your heart, will you please choose a word that stands out to you?
Love is patient and kind, never jealous or envious, never boastful or proud, never haughty or selfish or rude. Love does not demand its own way. It is not irritable or touchy. It does not hold grudges and will hardly even notice when others do it wrong. It is never glad about injustice, but rejoices whenever truth wins out. There are three things that remain: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. Amen.
You've heard of Jesus. You probably know about one of his famous teachings called the Golden Rule. Do to others what you would want them to do to you. And this, actually, is a restatement of something else that Jesus said, that the meaning of life is to love God and love your neighbor as yourself. Now, that's really beautiful, but what does he mean exactly by the word love? It's an unclear word in English, because you can love your mom and you can love pizza. And if the word love means the same thing in both of those cases, your mom's gonna feel real bad. So what did Jesus mean in his language? Well, first of all, this love your neighbor phrase is a quotation from the Hebrew scriptures, where the word for love is ahava. However, the language Jesus spoke and taught in from day to day, it was a cousin language of Hebrew, that is Aramaic, in which the word for love is rachma. But then, as Jesus' followers spread his teachings around the world, they translated them into Greek, using the word agape. But here's what's fascinating. The earliest followers of Jesus, who wrote the books of the New Testament in Greek, they didn't learn the meaning of agape by looking it up in ancient dictionaries. Rather, they looked to the teachings of Jesus and the story of his life to redefine their very concept of love. So one time, Jesus was asked about the most important command in the Jewish scriptures. And he first quoted from the ancient prayer in the Torah called the Shema, "Love the Lord your God with all of your heart." So love for God is the most important thing. But then Jesus quickly followed up by saying another command from the Torah was also the most important, to love your neighbor as yourself. So which is the most important, loving God or loving your neighbor? Jesus' answer is yes. To ask the question means you don't get his point. For Jesus, they are two sides of the same coin. Your love for God will be expressed by your love for people, and vice versa, they're inseparable. And so this makes it clear that for Jesus, agape love is not primarily a feeling for someone else that happens to you, like our phrase, I fell in love. For Jesus, love is action. It's a choice that you make to seek the well-being of people other than yourself. Jesus also went on to teach that genuine love for God and others means seeking people's well-being without expecting anything in return, especially from people who are in difficult situations, who can't repay you even if they wanted to. According to Jesus, this kind of generous love reflects the very heartbeat of God. And he took this even further. Jesus said that the ultimate standard of authentic love is how well you treat the person that you can't stand. Or in his words, you shall love your enemy and do good to them, expecting nothing in return. For Jesus, this kind of enemy-embracing love imitates the very character of God himself. Now, we wouldn't be talking about Jesus still today if he had only said things like love your enemy. This is how he actually lived. Jesus was constantly helping and serving the people around him in very practical and tangible ways. And he consistently moved towards poor and hurting people who couldn't benefit him in return. He showed love for the forgotten ones, the people who usually fall through the cracks. And when Jesus eventually marched into Jerusalem, he made himself an enemy of the leaders of his people by accusing them of hypocrisy and corruption. But then instead of attacking his enemies to overthrow them, he allowed them to kill him. Jesus died for the selfishness and corruption of his enemies because he loved them. After Easter morning, Jesus and then his followers claimed that it was the power of God's love for the world that was revealed in Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. As the Apostle Paul put it, God demonstrated his own agape for us in this: while we were still sinners, the Messiah died for us. Or in the words of the Apostle John, God's own agape was revealed when he sent his one and only Son into the world so that through him we could have life. And for John, then, this leads naturally to the conclusion, beloved ones, if that's how God has loved us, then we ought to show love for one another. So Christian faith involves trusting that at the center of the universe is a being overflowing with love for his world, which means that the purpose of human existence is to receive this love that has come to us in Jesus and then to give it back out to others, creating an ecosystem of others-focused, self-giving love. And that's the New Testament meaning of agape love.
We're going to have the 1 Corinthians 13, Kyle, that scripture on the screen again for you as it speaks to your heart. And as the song is sung over you, we ask that you respond. Maybe you want to respond by lighting a candle, possibly by kneeling at the altar, or maybe stay in your sacred space and let God's love wash over you.
Is not self-seeking or easily angered, and it keeps no memory of wrong. It never delights in evil, but rejoices in truth.
Let us hear the prayers of the people.
Caroline Christian asks for continued prayers for her granddaughter, Monique Kerber, as the family makes the decision to remove her from the ventilator. Prayers for peace for this family. Prayers for Harold McMillan in the nursing home with Parkinson and dementia. Prayers for Eleanor Porterfield, Marguerite Wyatt, Barrett Bird. Prayers for Mary Rader on her chemo journey. Prayers for Kate Norman, granddaughter of Fred Kellerman. Continued prayers for Diane Wyford and Arletta Jackson. Prayers for the Paige Murphy family. Paige passed away Saturday. Prayers for Brian Evans' father, Henry, for Homer Hunter, for Jolynn Ball as she improves and gaining strength at the White Sulphur Springs Care Center. Prayers for Marilyn Stahl, Nita Johnson's brother, Bud McGregor, who is in the hospital with two broken leg bones after a tree fell on him. Prayers for all of those that are suffering from the cold. Flo I thanks everyone for their gifts, cards, calls, and prayers. And prayers for Mary and Randy Humphrey's grandbaby, Mason, who has a very bad case of the flu. And all of our unspoken concerns, both in the sanctuary and online today.
Precious Heavenly Father, we draw our hearts and minds close to you this morning, God. Lord, we are thankful for your agape love for us. And God, we know there is nothing that can separate us from your love, God. Oh, God, we have so many prayers and concerns, God, but you know about each and every one of us, God. You know what we need, God. And Lord, we just ask you to grant us, God, the things that show your love. Oh, God, we appreciate your love so much, God. Oh, God, we just know that if we give it all to you, God, everything will be all right. Oh, God, we're just so thankful. We give all glory and praises to you this morning, God. Oh, God, we'll just lift up your holy name and just call out to you when we need your help, God. But you know that you know. And God, we just continually give you honor and praise, God. And God, we love you more than you can imagine. And God, we just thank you. We're so grateful. Be with us, God, as we go throughout this week. Help us to show your love to each and every one, God. Keep everyone in our prayers. God, our Father, thank you. In your name's sake, we do pray. Amen.
During the series, we've been giving you spiritual homework. It's in the bottom corner of your bulletin, and it says apply. So here's some opportunities for you to grow, because if we just came to church on Sunday mornings for an hour, there wouldn't be a whole bunch of growth. This gives you an opportunity to dig in deeper with your relationship with Christ. Here's our homework. Define for yourself what faith, hope, and love really mean to you. Don't Google it. Write what it means to you. Seek to do one loving thing this week that you might not regularly do. Search in the scriptures for a scripture on love and read it. That you can Google. Read a scripture on love. May we love God. May we understand that we are loved, and may we love others. Let's stand together for our musical benediction.
You ready? We're so thankful that you join in every Sunday on our live stream, and this is where it all takes place, up in the balcony, so that we can connect with you in your homes and we can all worship together. Thank you for faithfully giving so that we can continue ministries like this one. If you would like to give, you can write a check and mail it to P.O. Box 69. You can always bring it to church or to worship. And of course, you can give online. Thank you again for faithfully giving and faithfully attending.